John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. I'm still here in New Zealand, and today I'm actually going on a hike, actually up Mount Tauhara. It's like a 500 meter incline up to the top. Hope I make it up there. But I thought in this episode what I'd do, I'm going to try to share with you guys like 14 different tips on what I learned on my hike and how that can benefit you from having a vegetable garden, or how you could have a better vegetable garden by learning about the forest. All right, so let's head on the hike. All right, so we started our hike, and basically looks like we have to hike through some fields first, which actually they're obviously grazing because there's cow paddies everywhere, so you gotta avoid the cow paddies. You can see the cows behind us, and you know, a lot of people have this idea that we need to have holistic grazing and have more cows to save the planet, to put carbon back in the soil, and they could save the planet, right? Well, you know, in my opinion, there's better and worse ways to do things, right? What I'm gonna show you guys, we're gonna take you up to the forest, which is actually right up over there, right? And in my opinion, this area that I'm standing at right here, before literally settlers came and developed this area, probably used to be all trees, and it got all cut down to use nature's resources to turning this back into forest, in my opinion, would be a lot more beneficial for the planet than to actually have more cows and to, you know, even do holistic grazing management. What I hope to show you guys in this episode is actually some of the techniques the forest uses to build soil and actually create a healthier world. So tip number one is I want you guys to harness the power of carbon in the tree. So here they basically just took a bunch of trees, they did trimming, and they basically just cut them up into pieces and just laid them down. Whether you want to put those in a wood chip so they break down faster, whether you just want to lay full pieces of tree logs on your property, and of course this depends if you're in like a, have acreage or in a residential spot, use the power of the wood chips to basically let it break down over time. The fungi will come, break this stuff down into a rich a fungal compost that can actually take a few years. If you don't want to wait so long, then you actually just buy a fungal dominated compost to actually add to your garden beds. Tip number two is use clean water. On the hike here, we just came across a stream, and this whole forest is literally watered by clean water, either from rain or from the, you know, the snow melt, the ice melt off the hill as it runs down to feed the entire forest clean water. And in our modern day and age, unfortunately, we have contaminated wells, city water that they're adding fluoride and chlorine and chloramines to. So, you know, I encourage you guys to let rain water your garden, whether you're gonna let rain water it directly or catch your rainwater, hold your rainwater in, you know, holding tanks, and then filter it, water your garden if need be, or minimally use a hose end filter to filter the water coming out of the city tap to take some of the bad contaminants such as the chlorine and chloramine out that can negatively impact the microbes in your garden. Another thing here in the forest is number three is grow diversity. There's just not all corn plants growing in the forest. There's hundreds of different kinds of species and types of different plants growing, from ferns to trees and shrubs to little smaller things growing out of the ground, which I don't even know because I just know the edible plants. But I do know there is diversity, and I don't want your gardens to be like a monoculture and only grow one thing. Grow so many different kinds of different things, and you'll have a greater probability of success for your garden to look like the forest. Tip number four is to keep your ground covered. It's like if you go to a job and you always got to watch behind your you know what, because somebody's going to report you for doing something. You got a CYA. I want to encourage you guys to CYG, cover your ground here in the forest. Basically, as you can see, there's just plants all over, many different kinds of plants. And if there's not plants, then there's basically woody material, branches, sticks, or even leaves covering the ground so that it can encourage the microbial growth. Number five is don't do what I'm doing here on the path in the forest. You know, basically the whole forest is untrampled on, except for when people cut through parts they're not supposed to. Everybody goes on this one path, and that's a good thing, so that the whole forest system is not damaged. When you're walking on the trail here, it's really slippery. It'd be good for mud football. The water is eroding away. There's no really roots or plants to hold the soil in place. The nutrients are washing away. It's really not a good place for the plants because of the human traffic. So I don't want you guys in your garden to step on your raised beds, to step on the soil, to step on the places you guys are planting your plants. You know, have walkways next to your beds where you are actually planting your plants, but don't step on the beds. It compacts the soil, you know, and it just will constantly erode. and not be good. And if you do want to convert something like this that's been heavily walked on into a grow bed, you know, I would recommend sheet mulching really good and piling on some compost and some other good soil to grow in that, or just add tons of microbes to your existing ground to try to bring that alive again. Once the soil is compacted, the microbes don't tend to thrive in that situation. Number six is grow what grows easy. Everything in the forest here belongs here. It wasn't planted by anyone. Seeds come in, they germinate, they come up, and guess what? If this is the perfect climate for those plants, they're gonna flourish, they're gonna survive, they're gonna grow big, they're gonna reproduce, and there's gonna be more of them. And if they're not the proper selection for this climate zone, for this area, for the rainfall, then they're not gonna survive. So I want you guys in your gardens to pick the plants that'll do well for you. And this can be depending on your specific region, your specific climate, the specific time of year. Check with the master gardeners in your area. They've done research on some of the vegetables that tend to do better or worse in your area. Also, the AAS selections of vegetables tend to do pretty good. And also, don't forget about other edible foods, whether that's edible weeds like dandelion, like plantain, like I've seen here, plentiful in the countryside. Grow some of those guys too, because they're gonna be the easiest garden you guys could have to grow some food. Number seven is, I want you guys to create your own leaf mold compost. I mean, just right next to the trail, you can see this place is littered with leaves, some fresh, but mostly decayed. And if we just scoot this back underneath, you know, we got some really nice, rich black soil. I'm seeing some mycorrhizal fungi threads and all kinds of different earthworms and all these different creatures living in there, right? And the leaf mold will basically give you a 50-50 mix of fungal and bacteria to basically add into your garden. This is something that's very essential because most people just use like a hot pile compost that adds mostly the bacterial base. And in my opinion, most gardeners are missing the fungal component. Number eight is, leave your roots in the ground when you're done growing your plants for the season, right? Here we are on the hiking trail, and there's just all these roots coming through the trail, and yes, they're getting tripped over. People are probably maybe even falling. Actually, I use the roots as stepping stones so I don't get my feet in the mud. But these guys, whether they're alive or not, are left here in place to compost and break down if they're no longer alive and go the way of the West. And I want you guys to do that also in your vegetable gardens. After your season, don't just uproot your plants and throw them in a compost pile, right? Clip it off at the base, leave the roots in the ground to feed the microbes in the soil, to feed the earthworms you're gonna find next season. When you pull that up, it might be gone, or it's just gonna be eaten with worms and other microbes that are gonna actually increase your soil fertility. Number nine is, I want you guys to have proper moisture level in your gardens. I mean, here in the forest, literally there's trees above, there's leaves on the ground, there's lots of organic matter in the soil. So the soil has good water holding capability. And I know some people might be gardening in sand and then things drain out, or if you have too much sand content in your mixes, they'll drain out. That could be a good thing, but also a bad thing, because water doesn't hang out and go to the roots of the plants where they need to be. It drains out way too quickly. So for this, I like to add things like organic matter, whether that's in the form of compost or whether that's in the form of something like the coconut coir or the peat moss that'll help retain some moisture in the soil so your plants can get the proper amount. Number 10, I want you guys to encourage soil microlife and basically life in the soil. I mean, here in the forest, there's basically just things composting down. Maybe some things got burnt at one time, and it's basically composting in place and turning in and feeding all the microbes and making a really rich soil. So what that means, bringing in compost, making your own compost tea or other soil inoculants, whether that's mycorrhizal fungi or other, bringing in other bacterial inoculants. I want you guys to add those to your garden because they are existing here in nature before man started getting involved in spraying chemicals everywhere. So the next tip I want you to do is, I want you to grow pollinators here in the forest. There's all kinds of different plants. There's pollinating plants, there's plants that attract beneficial insects. Nature's a complete system that basically hasn't been messed with too much by man. But when you are growing a garden, you guys could bring in other native plants, pollinator plants, and even plants to attract the beneficials. I mean, here on these little flowering plants, there's like a little spider guy, there's like these little pollinator flies, standard flies, and I even saw some bees earlier. So number 12, I want you guys to amend your soil with things that would naturally occur in the forest, like right here I'm sitting on, and this is just basically all this little gravel stuff that basically erodes over time. And New Zealand here is basically formed by volcanoes, so there's volcanic rock, basalt rock, different kinds of rocks, and the rocks add the trace minerals in the soil. And with conventional agriculture and all the rains, like I'm getting rained on here, the topsoils get eroded away and we lose the mineral content. So it's very important to put that back in your soil so your plants could have the super immunity that the plants of the forest have. In addition, they'll also taste better and they're also gonna grow faster. Besides rock dust, you could also use things like the seaweeds, which could also be really important. All right, so number 13 is, here in the forest, there's no even organic sprays. Nobody's spraying like neem oil pesticide that's organic in the forest. There's literally no pesticide being sprayed. And this should be the goal for every organic gardener, is actually to not have to spray anything, except one thing that I spray is water, because things would get naturally rained on. And actually I do spray water through a high pressure hose, because that's not really gonna negatively affect the bad bugs or the good bugs. See, when we spray anything, even if it's organic approved, it could harm the beneficial bugs. It could actually harm the soil microbiome. So I encourage you guys, much like the forest here, is to not spray anything. And yeah, you know, there'll be some leaves with some holes in it, right? But the goal is, in my opinion, is to build the fertility of the soil, right? Plants that live out in nature, especially here in the forest, have to make their own immune system, have to make their own plant chemicals or phytochemicals within them to prevent bugs and other creatures and molds and rusts from attacking and getting on them. So if you have truly healthy plants, you're not gonna have the level of pest pressures that most people do. So I finally made it to the top, and the 14th and final tip that I have for you guys after hiking literally like an hour and a half of this, literally through the forest, sharing with you guys all these tips is, never give up, right? It was a long hike. We thought we were getting near the end and we had another 15 minutes, but in life or in gardening, whatever you guys are doing, never give up. Always have persistence. And you know, even if you fail, like, you know, if you fall on the hike up and get all muddy, that's all right. Pick yourself up, keep going to make it to the end, right? And likewise in gardening, right? If things fail, your plants don't make it, that's all right. Get new plants, start over, do things a little bit differently, and you'll be successful one of these times for sure, like I've made it to the top of the mountain today. That's pretty much the end of this episode. If you guys enjoyed this episode learning about vegetable gardening from the forest, hey, please be sure to give me a thumbs up. That'll encourage me to do more videos like this, you know, off the cuff, when I'm traveling or wherever in the world I happen to be. Also be sure to share this video with fellow gardeners so that they could get some of my tips also, and hopefully they could also improve their vegetable gardens by using some of the tips that I've shared with you guys today. Also be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on any of my new and upcoming episodes that come out about every 3 to 4 days, you never know where I show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1,300 episodes at this time, teach you guys all aspects on how you guys could grow your own food at home. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. Until then, remember, keep on growing.